I am so blessed to be the pastor of this church and have this wonderful, talented people that serve along with me. And I thank the Lord for all of you, amen, who come each and every week. And boy, it's great when you get with the family of God. It's great. I'm looking forward to when we gather on the other side. We don't have to depart company anymore, you know. We can just fellowship with one another for eternity, forever and forever and forever. What a wonderful time that's going to be. To see our friends and loved ones who's gone on before as well. Now, with that said, this morning we're going to focus our attention back upon that first Christmas morning when Christ came to this earth to dwell with mankind. And why did he come? Because he loved us so. Well, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. He gave him to us for a period of 33 years here on this earth, but he gave his life, amen, that we may have life. And that we can have it more abundantly, amen, and enjoy life. Enjoy life. But when we come to this time of the year, we see a lot of things that, you know, sometimes it's not exactly the way the Bible said it was. We have Christmas cards where we got three wise men on it that comes and lay gifts at the little baby Jesus' cradle. And the Bible, you know, certainly tells us there are wise men that came and sought Jesus. We talked a little bit about it last week. They came and sought out the child. But by the time the wise men got there, he wasn't a little baby any longer. He wasn't an infant. He was between the ages of two. So at the time they got there, it wasn't at the birth. Amen. It was later on down the road. And a lot of times we think there is only three wise men, right? Because they gave three gifts. But the Bible didn't specify a number of wise men that sought Jesus. If you look at the count in Matthew 2, it says wise men. It didn't say three. We assume there was three because of the three gifts. And you know what happens when we assume, right? You know? So we don't want to assume anything. The Bible did not specify how many wise men sought the Lord, but we knew that was more than maybe three. There were probably some more there with them. But we know that they gave three gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And they may have been multiple gold and frankincense and myrrh from the wise men. However, amen, let's go on a little bit further here. Today in the Gospel of Luke, we'll find that the angels came to shepherds to give them the good news of the birth of Christ. So we want to find out a little bit this morning, why did the angels come to these shepherds? Have you ever wondered why did the angels proclaim the magnificent birth to just lowly shepherds in the field watching and tending their sheep? Have you ever wondered? I've wondered. Because inquiring minds like mine wants to know. Some of you are curious too. You want to know. Matter of fact, if you see a police car next to the neighbor, wonder what they're doing over there. If you see an ambulance next door, what are they doing over there? What's going on over there? Has a neighbor got hurt? What in the world's going on? So inquiring minds want to know. I want to know. Don't you want to know? Let's have fun today. I want to know. Why did the angel come to the shepherds and proclaim the great news of Christ's birth? Well, the Bible tells us here in Luke chapter 2 in verse 8. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around about them, and they were so afraid. Notice that the angels appeared to these shepherds out tending their flock, doing ordinary stuff, an ordinary day, and doing, amen, exactly what they've been doing for many and many a year. But the angels all of a sudden appeared unto them, and said, hey guys, I got some news for you. And the Bible said they were afraid. I believe you and I would be afraid if God showed up, amen, with some angels, amen, and scared us half to death. Huh? Wouldn't it? If an angel all of a sudden appeared while you were cooking, I expect we'd have some burnt chicken. Because you'd be passed out. The angels all of a sudden appeared, amen, out in the field, out of nowhere, and says, "Hey, guys, I got some news for you." Well, why did you pick us? Did we do something wrong? As a matter of fact, they knew they was the lowest of the lowest. They know that many people thought they was shifty, dishonest, basically a bunch of thugs. Hello? That's what the people thought of shepherds in this time period. And when the angel showed up, they thought, amen, God's wrath done caught up with them. They were so, didn't it say they were so afraid? Wow. So afraid. And the angel said, what? And the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." All people. All people. I bring you some good news that will be joy to all people. And then he goes on, and the angels said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you great tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." I like the fact that the angels showed up, amen, to these shepherds out in the field, these lowly meekness of people in the world. Because, see, God likes to show up and meet us where we are. Let me say that one more time, because some of you done fell asleep on me. God likes to show up, amen, exactly where we are in life. He likes to meet us in our pain and in our loneliness. He likes to show up, amen, when we are frustrated and angry. And boy, that's when we need it most, don't we? Before we say something we'll regret. You know, he likes to meet up with us on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Doing our ordinary work day, doing our ordinary life day, he likes to show up, amen, and meet with us. I think that's why God sent the angels to the shepherd to let us know that this child was for all people and all races. "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." That is good news. That is joy to all people. And the Greek word for all is all. He came for all mankind, regardless of their status. If he had came to the kings in that day and gave them the message about his birth, then we would have thought that he just came for the rich and the popular. But since he came to the lowliest of the lowliest, amen, he came for all people, identifying with all mankind, all types, rather, amen, from the bottom to the top of society. He came for all. And I'm glad, glory to God, that he came for all. Amen. Because I never would have made it. Amen. If he came for the top first. But he came for the bottom, honey. And he came to the bottom because I was way below the bottom. He lifted me up. Amen. And put my foot on a solid rock. Glory to God. And point my direction toward heaven. And I am glad today that Jesus loves me. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. I'm glad Jesus loves me. Aren't you glad he reached way below the bottom and got you? Oh, I said, aren't you glad he reached way below the bottom and got you? Oh, we don't sound like it. Let me hear you. I said, aren't you glad he reached way below the bottom for you? Amen. The shepherds were shocked. And I'm sure some of you were shocked when the Lord showed up at your doorstep and told you, "Hey, you need me. You need me in your life. Your life's a wreck. You are accidentally looking for a place to happen. Aren't you glad, amen, he came in and redirected your life and brought you out of a terrible situation? Glory to God. Hallelujah. There's a story that's been shared many times across the pulpits of America about a young man. He wanted to go to church, and he had some wild hair, wore worn T-shirts with holes in it, jeans, which are popular today with all the holes in it. He wanted to go to church. Went to the church, and when he came into the side of the door of the church on that Sunday, it wasn't a place for him to sit. The church was packed. He tried to find his way through and see where he could sit, but there was no one who would get up and even offer him a seat. But he wanted to be in church, and he had that desire in his heart. So he made his way up to the front, and you know, up front here, plenty of vacancy. I don't understand why folks go to the concert, they want to sit on the front. When they come to church, they want to sit in the back. You ever wonder that? Inquiring minds want to know. Man, we pay high dollars to sit up front in the concert and sit in the cheap seats in the back of the church. I don't understand. But he made his way up to the front here where this area was, and he just sat down on the rug. Everybody just stared. Just like y'all staring at me. Everybody just stared. Finally, an old gentleman in the back with his walking cane started making his way up to the front. And it was so silent in the church that only you could hear the tapping of the cane as the old gentleman made his way up front where this young man sat. The old man, he finally reached where the young man sat, and he began to make his motion to sit with him. And he was helped by the young man to sit there. And he said, I just want to join you. Just want to join you and worship with you today, my friend. Do you see the love that God just illustrated in that story to us? God saw the shepherds, the lowliest of the lowliest of society. But he came in and he said, I just want to sit with you. I just want to tell you some great news. Hey, that I've come to bring joy to all people. All people, including you, my friend. I love you. I care for you. I want you to be saved. I want you to be born again into the family of the Most High God. I want you to go from the lowest status, amen, to the highest. Woo! My, boy. I serve the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords. Amen. The greatest of all presidents. I serve the King of kings. Amen. And his name is Jesus. He took me, amen, from the muck and the mire, cleaned me up so I could sit on the King's table. Amen. Woo! I like that. I'm a King's kid. And friend, let me tell you, amen, if you're born again into the family of God, you're a King's kid. Amen. Don't settle for less. Amen. Because you're a King's kid. Don't settle for what the world has to offer. Because God has given you the best. Don't settle for what the world has offered. God has given you the best. Just trust Him. Amen. Trust Him. Oh, boy. I know a lot of folks. Amen. I try to find this song too, but I don't know if it was a one-time thing or not. But I sure did love it when I was a kid. And it goes a little bit something like this. Hey, I don't have to settle for less, cause I'm a king's kid. And all the riches of the kingdom now mine. I've been purchased by the blood and I've been adopted. And now I'm living like a king's kid all the time. Yeah, glory to God. Amen. Some of y'all ought to shout amen and say, oh me, oh my, something amen. Praise God, amen. We've been adopted into the family of God. Why? Because of Christ's birth, amen. He loved us, amen. He died on the cross of Calvary for us. And then he rose victorious over death, hell, and grave, amen. Giving us power over death. to give us eternal life one day in heaven with him. Boy, amen. Yeah, they were shocked. I was shocked too, amen, that God would save an old country boy like me. But thank God, amen, he loved me. And he did, amen. Oh, why? Because he loved mankind. He loved mankind. In this account here in Luke chapter 2, we discover the heart of God and the meaning of his birth of this child. God sent his son because he loved us. God sent his son to die for us because he loved us. God, amen, gave resurrection power to his son, and he rose victorious over death, hell, and the grave because he loved us. He ascended to heaven because he loved us. He is interceding for you and I there. And he's coming back one day because he loved us. He's coming back one day because he's loved. And in this story, we see God's great love. That he wants to meet us in our ordinary position on our ordinary day. And he's there to meet our very need. Third thing I want you to see this morning. The shepherd says, hey, let's go check this thing out that the angels told us about. Amen? Let's go check it out. And let's go to the next verse in verse 12. Amen? And it says, and thou shalt be a sign upon you. You shall find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there were with the angels a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in the manger. And when they had seen it, they made known around abroad the saying which was told of them concerning this child. Man, he showed up. To ordinary people. The ordinary people believed in his love that he wanted to share with them. They said, hey man, we were shocked, we was afraid, but now, hey, let's go see. Let's go see, because seeing is believing. Seeing is believing. And the heavenly chorus sang glory to God. After this powerful display of praise, the shepherds just had to see for themselves this great news they had received. They had to see it in person. So they ran and with haste. I mean, they were smoking it, amen. You know, they was making time. They was humping it. They was moving on. They went to Bethlehem. They found the babe. They hurried to that place where he laid. And after seeing, they reported the message that was told to them of the child. And they became witnesses for God. Because seeing is believing. I have not seen God with my physical eyes. But I've seen him in his written word. I've seen him in his written word. And Jesus told his disciples, he said, blessed are you that you have seen, but more blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. And see, we are more blessed than the disciples were, who actually physically saw this child, Christ. We are more blessed. Boy, not only are we adopted into the family as king's kid, but we are more blessed than the very original disciples who saw it with their physical eyes. We're blessed. We're blessed beyond measure because faith is what, amen, it takes to believe in this baby called Christ. Which he's not a babe any longer, but he is the reigning king of all kings. And he will return in like manner, amen, as the king of kings and the Lord of lords. He won't come in a manger again. He won't be born in a manger again. He won't be an infant any longer, but he will be who he said he was, as God of the universe. Jesus, the creator of all things, the mighty God, the wonderful counselor, the Prince of Peace. When I think of my God, and I think about his first coming here and what the Bible says about his second coming, I stand in awe. Because, see, the world is not getting better, it's getting worse. We as nations seek peace, but we'll find no peace. Why? Because we're seeking it in man. Man is flawed at his best, but God is perfect at his best. And the only one can bring peace to an entire world is God himself. He is the Prince of Peace. Man will not know peace until they know God. You'll have no peace in your life until you surrender to God. Then you can find the joy that the angels proclaim to the shepherds. Joy. Jesus, others, and yourself. And when we have that proper priority in our life, then we can enjoy life and have peace at heart. A peace that passes all understanding. A peace that is not even, amen, comprehensible by our infinite mind. Only God can do that. And only God will bring peace to this world one glorious day. All the armies of the world, it says, going to gather. And they're going to beat their plows in plowshares. Amen. Their weapons into plowshares. Why? They won't need them any longer. Won't need them any longer. Because the Prince of Peace will step foot on earth once again. Will you be with him? Will you be with him? I'm planning on it. I'm planning on it. If you don't know whether you'll go to heaven today or not, then friend, then you need to make preparation, because he can come any hour, any given day. Any hour, any given day for you or me. You're not guaranteed that you'll see Christmas Day. Many who started January 1st, 2019 didn't see December 31st, 2019. We hadn't seen it yet. We may not even see it. Because, amen, of that uncertainty, we need to be prepared. And how do you get prepared? Jesus said, come to me, all who are laden with a heavy burden, and I'll give you rest. Seek refuge for your soul. If you never invited Christ in your heart, the Bible said we are all sinners, amen, at that point. We need Christ. We need Christ in our heart. We was all born in sin. There's none of us righteous, no, not one. The only righteous we have is in Christ Jesus. And we need to turn our life to him and say, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner, and Lord, come into my heart and save my soul. That's preparation, friend. Your soul is prepared to meet God. When you ask for forgiveness, God said he'll grant that forgiveness. And he'll wipe all the sinful and disobedience act that is against him and his word away from you. He'll cast your sins as far as east is from west. I know there are smart people in the world. Can you tell me how far east is from west? It's unending. And if he casts them as far as east is from west, then they'll never trouble you again. They'll never be brought up again in God's sight. Thank God for that grace and mercy. Amen. A lot of people won't forgive you in that fashion. But God will. God will. We just need to be prepared to meet him. Surrender it all to him. And when we do, he gives us that clean slate that we can live with him. When we have closed our eyes in death and our last breath of life leaks from our body, he said, I'll be waiting for you. I'll be waiting for you. I just got to share this for closing. Now, I've shared it with you a thousand and thousands of times. And if you stay here and the Lord let me tarry here, amen, you'll probably hear a thousand more. But Jesus has promised me that if I surrender my life to him, because he loved me, he loved you, he was the one who died for you. He didn't send an angel to do that. He did it himself. And he was willing to love me enough to die for me. He loves me enough to come and get me when this life here comes to a close. In John 14, Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled." And listen to this very carefully. He said, "If you believe in me, believe in God, believe also in me." If you believe in God, believe also in me. Because he's incarnated, amen, God in the flesh. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I like what he says. If I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there he may be also. And whether I go, he know, and the way he know. Thomas said unto him, "Lord, we know not whether I go." He said, "How can we know the way?" Jesus said unto him, "I am the way, truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father except by me." Think about that, amen. Ain't no angels coming, amen, to get my soul. Jesus said he's going to claim that for his own. I will come again and receive. They might escort him, amen. He might have Secret Service angels with him, amen. But he don't need them. You know, he don't need them. And bless God, amen, amen. He said, "I'm coming to get you. It's going to be me and Jesus when my last mile is over. It's going to be me and Jesus. How about you? Is it going to be you and Jesus? Is it going to be you and Jesus? Only you know the answer. I only know it for me. I don't even know it for my wife. I only know it for me." And that's the same with you. You only know what's in your heart. And I pray Jesus is there. Let us stand. Our Heavenly Father, God, as we come to you today, Lord, we thank you, God, for the word that we've heard through song and through the word today. And God, we looked at this message today, and Father, how amazed the shepherds were that you would even consider sending angels to proclaim your birth to them. And Father, how marvelous that was to see how you came to ordinary people to make them extraordinary people. And Father, they became the witness, God, that you had been born. God, may we today, in our ordinary state, become extraordinary people in you, Lord, that we may proclaim, God, not only your first coming, but your second coming is near. And Father, that hearts need to be ready to meet you. My prayer today that everyone in the sound of my voice has made that preparation. Perhaps not, Lord, there may be one or two, God, or however many, Lord, in here. Lord, you know the hearts. But if it's one in the sound of my voice had made that preparation today, Father, I pray they'll seek you and ask God for your forgiveness in their lives.